Okay. Sir, can I speak? Yeah, warm. Good morning to all. This is Manikavasagam. I have been working as an assistant professor from Tamil Nadu, Dr. J. Jayatha Physics University. I welcome you all for this online training course on fishery oceanography for future professionals. I think this is the second batch. Last batch we have conducted last year, November. Then today I will discuss about revisiting the oceanographic processes. This process, how they influencing primary production, then probably secondary, then finally tertiary production like fish production, then so on. This is the content of the lecture. Introduction to oceanography and types, why oceanography is important, and what are the properties mainly causing the ocean to circulate. Then followed by our actual content of today's webinar is revisiting the oceanographic process, and mainly we will discuss species production point of view. Then finally, conclusion. Introduction to oceanography. There is a difference between ocean and oceanography. Ocean in the sense we can say only in the type of the oceans, what are the ocean present around the blue planet. But oceanography is the study of the ocean with emphasis on its character as an environment. It includes shape, size, depth and bottom relief of ocean, then how ocean has been distributed, then what are the different circulation pattern and the movement like ocean current and gyres or jetties or different kind of circulation will be there. Then different biological forms existing in the oceans are also studied in under oceanography stream. It has mainly four types. Under physical oceanography, the important parameters we will discuss: temperature, currents, tides, winds, and depth. Temperature will be based on how much sunlight is coming from sun to equator region compared to temperate region. Equator region will receive vertical sun rays, then pole region will receive oblique or slanting sun rays. Then current we can say as a ocean current, movement of water mass or water body one place to another place at a definite direction with different speed. Tides mainly formed by due to celestial body positions like sun, moon and earth. The high tide and low tide will be there. There's some of the special tide like neap tide or spring tide will be there. Then winds, mainly wind formed by difference in temperature and pressure difference. Then followed by depth, based on depth how much light is going, then how much light influencing different depth, then how much production is coming. Based on this light will determine the primary production in particular place, and also influence chemical oceanography. The chemical oceanography is also important to make primary production at certain places, mainly influenced by salinity, nutrients in the sense nitrate, phosphate, silicate and iron, finally DO. Nitrate is the marine limiting nutrient. Why? Because its demand will be more for all those aquatic living organisms. Then followed by phosphate, this also mainly involving development of cells and other organelles. Then silicate is the important nutrient for formation of diatoms. Why? Because the diatom hypothica and epithica outer they are mainly based on this silica abundance. Then finally iron also act as a limiting nutrient for development of phytoplankton bloom. Then dissolved oxygen is one of the most important parameter. It will influence fish distribution and fish abundance. Then followed by biological oceanography we will discuss about primary productivity. And primary productivity in the sense the production of organic matter from inorganic substances like different nutrients and other kind of salts. Then if you go for species production, for species production, primary productivity is the base for species production. In aquatic food chain, primary production is the phytoplankton is the base of the food chain food web. Then we also influences primary, secondary and tertiary level. of food web. Then finally we will come geological oceanography. Geological oceanography, in the sense, we can study about different earth properties, like how under ocean the different structure is found. Then based on this structure, how the production occurring based on different patterns of circulations, like eddies or cyclones or different kind of thing will be there. Then other underwater structures like atolls, then trenches, this kind of different thing will be there. Then you can take, we can consider. Why oceanography is important? Before going to the oceanography process, we must know about why oceanography is important. Management of marine living resources for sustainable use, like future use. Marine fisheries nowadays contributing overall GDP along Indian as well as the world level. Then we want to detect and forecasting of some of the important oceanic parameters such as sea surface temperature, ocean color monitor through different sensors they will use. In INCOI, they will use ocean color monitor sensor. They will monitor this chlorophyll pigment. Based on this, they will generate potential fishing zone map. They will disseminate through various mechanisms to along Indian coastal fishermen. Then sea surface height, then followed by surface roughness. Then it also include protection and conservation of marine ecosystem. Then fragile ecosystems such as coral reefs, mangroves, seagrass and mudflats. These are the important ecosystem to involve, contribute to more fishery production. Coral reef, in the sense, we can simply say tropical rainforest of the sea. Then mangroves is a salt tolerant plant variety kind of forest ecosystem along coastal area. Then seagrass also involving capturing of carbon sequestrations. Then this kind of advantages will be there. Based on this, we have to protect this kind of fragile ecosystem to make our ecosystem more sustainable and more wealthy. Prediction and mitigation of natural hazards like tsunami and storm surges and cyclones and coral bleaching. Tsunami is mainly caused by internal wave, then storm surges due to inverse barometric effect. Cyclones, where the cyclone found mainly by where the low pressure area is surrounded by high pressure area. Then coral bleaching with the increase in sea surface temperature, mainly occur along the coral area. It will affect negatively the zooxanthellae and coral symbiotic relationship. Then finally, it leads to coral bleaching. Then this also we can monitor through different earth-based or in-situ-based platforms. Then national security, some of the national persons, they will use oceanographic data to move from one place to another place, then to identify any unauthorized activities going in ocean or as well as coastal. Then other important commercial activities such as shipping, navigation and fishing, ONGC, we can assist these people where oceanographic parameter move happening day-to-day phenomena or advance in 7 days before. We will send information to navigation people, then shipping, then the fishermen and the oil and natural gas corporation agencies. Then also strengthening and enlightening of education and the knowledge to professionals. These are the important properties mainly causing the ocean to circulate. First one is energy and matter. Energy and matter continually exchanged between the ocean and atmosphere, and these processes drive the ocean and atmosphere circulations. And some of the important hydrological cycles like evaporation. Evaporation, in the sense, conversion of liquid state into gaseous state. Precipitation, in the sense, after evaporation, it will have to attain gaseous state to liquid state. Then heating and cooling, this also bringing changes in temperature and salinity of the surface water of the ocean. based on this temperature and salinity, then ocean currents will form. Either in temperature region, in equator region, warm water will form. In cold region, then cold water will form. Then density also plays major role in water can cause or sink to can cause rise or sink in the oceans. Then kinetic energy, energy of motion is transferred from the wind or in motion to ocean depth of a few hundred meters. These are the important main oceanographic process influencing fisheries production along open ocean and coastal region. MLD, thermocline and halocline, neutrocline and oxycline. These are the vertical properties of water. MLD in the sense we can say is a mixed layer depth, and then thermocline, sudden change in temperature with respect to depth, similar to halocline. Coming slides we will see what how they vary based on depth. Then upwelling, mixing and downwelling. Upwelling means bottom nutrient rich middle water will come surface, then it will make more productive. Downwelling quite opposite to upwelling. Coming slides we will discuss in detail manner. Then ocean fronts, then ocean currents, then ocean eddies and gyres. These circulations are phenomena mainly formed by influence of earth rotation. Earth rotation means Coriolis effect, then wind patterns, then coastal geomorphology, then bottom topography, which playing a significant role in spatio-temporal distribution of fishery resources. What is MLD? MLD stands for mixed layer depth. It is a well-mixed layer, well-mixed upper layer of the sea, and it contributes typically 150 meter deep, and due to the fact it is well-mixed, temperature and salinity there, and therefore the density are fairly uniform. In this layer, all oceanographic parameters will be uniform. Then we can say it's a mixed layer depth, then followed by thermocline. Thermo means temperature, cline means sharp gradient, rapid change in temperature with respect to ocean depth, in the sense thermocline, similar to halocline, in the sense rapid change in salt concentration. Then pycnocline, rapid change in density. Then neutrocline, rapid change in nutrients. Then oxycline, rapid change in oxygen level. These all vertical properties of the ocean will vary based on depth and light concentration. In these pictures, I would like to explain based on depth how the temperature of the water will reduce exponentially beyond 500 meter of the water. Then temperature reduce around 4 degrees Celsius. The top surface of the layer will be around 22 to 23. In the sense where the sudden change happening, in the sense we can say it's a thermocline. Similarly, we can say it's a based on depth, the density of the salts will increase. Then whatever the high density salt, it will sink. Whatever low density salt, it will always float on the surface of water. Low density water will float above the high density water. Where the sudden change of salt concentration will be there, we can say as a halocline area. Then we can say increasing density. Density we can say as a pure water density will be 1. Then sea water will be 1.025. This difference mainly due to salt concentration. Based on depth, this will also increase. Then after some time, it will attain uniform kind of density 1.2020. Why? Because heavy salt will sink much faster than less salt. Neutrocline and oxycline. Neutrocline in the sense in top surface layer, organic matter will be more. Then if organic matter will be more, then production will be more. Then followed by here, mineralization will be more. Then decomposition will be more. This kind of activity will reduce the dissolved oxygen content of the water, where the this kind of activity will be intensively occurring. There oxygen minimum zone will form. Oxygen minimum zone will be there less than 0.2 mg per liter. we can say it's the oxygen minimum zone. Mainly based on breath, this oxygen level will increase. Why? Because as per Henry law, then solubility of gas based on depth, it will increase. Whether low temperature is there, the solubility of gas will be increased. The nitrate in surface, the nitrate will be less. And then if going on gradually towards the depth, then it gradually will increase. Then total dissolved carbon, this will also in surface layer will be less, and based on depth, it will increase. If we come for oxycline zone, we can say, we can classify three zones, then anoxic and hypoxic, then oxic. Oxy zone, we can consider as a fish distribution area. Then hypoxic zone, we can say as a less distribution area, 0.2 mg per liter. But this anoxic zone, this make highly stress to fish, then detrimental area for fish distribution. Whatever the fish present in fish is there, it will try to move away from this place. Why? Because fish is an aquatic organism, it needs more oxygen to respire and to survive there and make biological process effectively. It needs oxygen more than 2 mg per liter. It always move wherever the oxygen level more than 2 mg per liter in the ocean, it will move. The upwelling. Upwelling is the cold nutrient rich water that rises from the oceanic depth, usually near the continents, when wind blows over the surface away or along the equators. Upwelling is mainly caused by a balance between Coriolis force and wind stress and Ekman transport. Marine limiting nutrient, we can say is nitrate. Why? Because nitrate demand will be more in ocean. If we come for fresh water, phosphate will be more demand in fresh water medium. But in this course, we will discuss about mainly in the marine water, how it is affecting this nutrient. That upwelling mainly formed by this wind movement parallel to the coast. Whatever the subsurface nutrient rich water is bringing a nutrient to surface layer, that's it will act as a sunlit zone. Then whatever the plankton is there will make use of this nutrient. Then finally it will act as a primary productivity area. Then finally small fish will start to aggregate surface area of the oceans, like sardine, then lesser sardine, then mackerel, then anchovies, then different kind of fishes will be there. Then it will attract secondary consumer, then followed by tertiary consumer like tuna, then swordfish, other sharks, and different kind of high level trophic level fishes. This is the Coriolis force. Then Coriolis force, we can say as a in northern hemisphere, it will wind will deflect in right side. Then southern hemisphere, it wind will deflect in left side. This mainly found by rotation of earth. If you want to throw any ball or launching any satellite from pole region to equator region, if you come for this northern hemisphere, wind always deflect in right and right side. Our intended path is like this, but our actual landing or throwing location here, it will start to land or any kind of ball or satellite. Then this is the Ekman transport. When wind is moving 45 degree based on depth, that intensity of that wind will decrease. Then it will make one kind of spiral. Then up to certain depth, it will make distribute or send and circulate the water. Then we can say it's a Ekman transport. Filling and mixing. Marine ecosystems are supplied by nutrients that are recycled with the aphotic zone by influx from the intermediate and deeper water. The upwelled water is usually from the below pycnocline, deep water mass, and it's highly nutrient rich. When the wind blows over the surface of the ocean, it sets up a stress which causes the water to move in the same direction as the wind. If the Ekman transport is set up away from the coast, the surface water are moved offshore and replaced by deeper cold water that is upwelled close to the coast. These are the major upwelling regions of the world. Then in red dots, it's showing wherever the continuous mixing will occur. Upwelling will form wherever the cold water or warm water mixing. We can say it's a good forage place for fish. Then wherever the green dot, it is showing that is seasonal. Like in India, southwest monsoon, after southwest monsoon, here it will form swelling. It will long last for 2 to 3 months. Then the different blue color dot will be formed due to other circulation phenomena. What are the ecological importance of upwelling? You can say nutrients are brought up to the euphotic zone and maximum support of phytoplankton and zooplankton production, more food for fish and larger organisms, strong food chains and food web. Main importance of upwelling region is in around world oceans, it contributes 5%, but it can account around 25% of the world fish catch. So downwelling in the sense opposite to upwelling. Downwelling where the two water body mass will move towards each other in dive, wherever the upwelling will be there, then divergence will form, two water body mass will move away from the each other. This is the main difference between downwelling and upwelling. In downwelling occurs when the surface water converges and come together, pushing the surface water downwards. Region of downwelling have low productivity because of the nutrients get used up are not continuously resupplied by the cold nutrient rich water from below the surface. Ocean fronts are the areas of particular interest contributing to the continual nutrient mixing in the oceans. In oceanic front areas, there is a rapid change in temperatures, chlorophyll and salinity distribution. Mainly in the, it will occur in the horizontal gradients of these properties and homogeneous in the surrounding water mass. Usually this event takes form of long strips on the sea surface, may be connected to other oceanographic processes such as upwelling and currents, and it has significant effects on marine biology. The system tend to form zones of convergence of different water masses, resulting in accumulation of planktonic organisms. This further less dense water or more dense water rather than meeting place, it will make such a phytoplankton accumulation in this place also, making as a good place for fish. This kind of properties we can identify through satellite, through different sensors, AVHR, advanced very high resolution radiometer. Based on that, they will identify frontal regions, then sea surfaces temperature. Then they will use this product to develop map. Ocean currents are coherent streams of water moving through the ocean and include long permanent structures like Gulf Stream or smaller episodic flows, drift, or any other small water flow in coastal and open oceans. These are mainly formed by wind blowing across the surface of the ocean, then differences in their temperature and density of pressure of water and of air, and location of continents and topography of the ocean bottom. How continents is located around the world, then what are the topography of the ocean bottom? In the sense, we can see different structures, trenches, seamounts, gyres, these also increasing forming different kind of circulation like ocean current, eddies, gyres. Based on three properties, we can classify current, like first one is depth. Based on depth, we can classify surface current and deep current. Based on speed and direction, we can classify the drift and current and stream. Based on temperature, in equator region, we can consider say as a warm current. In cold region, we can say as a cold current. In world oceans, fastest current is Gulf Stream. In this picture, I would like to explain that blue arrow indicate cold current, warm arrow indicate warm current. Wherever the cold and warm current is meeting, that this place will make a good place for Peruvian anchovies, and then shale. This kind of place will be more productive area in ocean, in the sense fish production. Then wherever the this also will make a more productive upwelling region. Here also will make more productive. Then here also will make productive. Then these other places will make a much more fish production. Based on this ocean current is important to study for future. Patterns of ocean current sands, it plays a major role in migration routes of marine species, are predicted upon moving against the flow of current. If suppose any spawners is moving against the current, you can say it's a counterattack, it's a technical word. Then optimizing subsequent downstream drift of eggs and larvae, wherever the eggs and larvae drifting along with the current, we can say as a denatant. Ocean currents are an important abiotic factor that significantly influences food webs and reproduction of marine organisms. Many species with limited mobility, like turtle, they will use ocean current. They will move from one place to another place for food, spawning, then other biological processes. Then it will also distribute larvae and reproductive cells from one region to another region. Even fish and mammals living in the ocean may have their destination and food supply affected by these currents. Ocean eddies, another important circulation parameter. Ocean eddies. An eddy is a current of water or air running contrary to the main current, especially as like a small whirlpool. The dimension or size of this eddy will be 10 to 100 kilometers. However, it long lasts up to 10 to 100s of days. Main mechanism involving to generate this eddy will be baroclinic instability. Baroclinic instability is where vertical shear will happen when the current will move from one region to another region, then followed by topographic steering, then wind, residual waves, then local barotrophic in the sense, any horizontal shear will happening while current or any other water movement occurring in oceans. In this isotherm is a constant temperature line, where it connecting the temperature will be the uniform. This is the this red color will be a cold water, warm water, then green color will be a warm cold water. Wherever the mixing will be there, the production will be more. Then it will also inject dissolved oxygen nutrients from surface area to subsurface area to surface area. Different types and characteristics of eddies will be there. First one is cyclonic eddy, then anticyclonic eddy, then interaction between eddies and non-eddy zones. Cyclonic eddy in the sense cold core area, cold core eddy. Then core area of cyclonic eddy will be more productive, like upwelling region. Then periphery area is less productive, considered as a convergence. Convergence means two water mass will move away from each other. Then divergence, convergence means two water body mass will move towards each other. Then divergence means two water body will move away from each other. The anticyclonic eddy is quite opposite to cyclonic. In core area will be less productive, then periphery area will be more productive. Then interaction between eddies, converging flows and diverging flows. Then non-eddy zones, sea levels increased by non-eddy process, like any other climate change impact, any other tidal activity, this kind of thing will be there. It will also change the sea levels. The importance of ocean eddies to fisheries. The eddies reduce the thermocline depth, then bring nutrients to the photic zone and improving the productive in stratified, tropical and subtropical regions of the oceans. Mesoscale eddy also improves the productivity at every trophic level, such as prime production. Prime production in the sense the production of organic matter from inorganic sources. It will increase zooplankton concentration, micronutrient concentration, then it will enter on attracts of plankton feeders like herbivores, then followed by carnivores. Finally, it will attract tertiary level producers, tunas, marlin, then turtles, seabirds, and cetaceans. Mainly, we can identify this eddy through different satellite. They will use radar. Radar will send radio waves based on this wave coming and going. What is the difference between the frequency, then the wavelength, they will identify the sea level. How sea level in the sense sea surface height. Gyres are large spiraling circulations, thousands of miles in diameter and rimmed by large and permanent ocean currents. Usually, gyres are characterized by certain seasonality and varying duration, strength, and size. These gyres, another type of upwelling. This process stresses are open sea upwelling events of dynamic pumping of bottom water to the surface. Depending on the direction of the process, a gyre may create a region with a warmer or cold resistivity. Then monitoring of gyre activity in the oceans become important. Because why? Because it reveals surface geostrophic current. Geostrophic current is defined as a balance between horizontal pressure gradient force and the correlation force. Then seasonal chlorophyll concentration. Then seasonal offshore fish breeding ground. For this purpose, we have to identify the gyres. Then we'll improve our fisheries. These are the different gyre formations in the world oceans. Totally 5 gyres are found in the world oceans. In Indian Ocean gyre will be there. Due to this Coriolis effect, the wind will deflect in left side. That is the reason that the rotation will form like this. Then in northern hemisphere of Indian Ocean, they are completely blocked by landmass. That is the main reason where gyre will absent. Then South Atlantic gyre, that same rotation will form in southern hemisphere, in South Atlantic and the South Pacific gyre. If we go for north side, the North Atlantic gyre, due to Coriolis effect, that movement of this Coriolis effect, that wind will always deflect in right side. Then here also will form northern Pacific. It will rotate like this. Some of the oceanic environment indicating fish abundance, in the sense like ocean conditions here and a fish abundance. Based on this condition, fish abundance will be more. Thermal fronts, favorable chlorophyll conditions, upwelling zones, cyclonic eddies, wherever this kind of phenomena occurring, then that place fits more chances of high fish catch. It has very high probability to get maximum fish catch. If we get a maximum CPUE, then it will increase fisherman income. Then finally it will contribute increase in country GDP. Thermal fronts, favorable chlorophyll condition, then cyclonic it is. If anyone like absent in these conditions, it will make high probability. Then this in this favorable chlorophyll condition, upwelling zones, here cyclonic it is will occur. This will also make more high probability. In open ocean, some of the indicators are playing important role to find the fish food in coastal region and open sea. The problem that occurs next is where to look for fishing location in the vast oceans. In ocean is very vast, we can't able to locate where the fish is located. But if you correlate with the different kind of biological indicator, we can easily find where the fishery is located based on different kind of phytoplankton abundance or zooplankton or different kind of plankton will be there to indicate particular fishery. These are the indicator organism. This is the name of the fishery. Indeed, these are the indicator organism. These are oceans. In which ocean the abundance will be more? In Indian Ocean, North Indian Ocean, Indian Sahel will be more. West region of North Indian Ocean. Then fragile ocean is a small diatom. It will also indicate Indian oil sardine. Subsequently, that lesser sardine, Hemiriscus salmoneus, this is also one of the phytoplankton species indicator for lesser sardines. It will mainly distribute in Bay of Bengal. This Indian oil sardine mainly distribute in Arabian Sea. Bombay duck, one of the important fishery along the North Indian Oceans like Gujarat in west side of North Indian Ocean, in east side Indian Ocean of is West Bengal. And this is mainly distributed by Asterias indicus distribution. Then tuna, then black knife tenbird, then herring, carnage are kind of water player. In North Sea it is more. Then blue whale, Euphorcia superba, is Antarctic krill. It will indicating the blue whale where the abundance will be more. Then basking shark will indicate Calanus, then Antarctic krill. Then Antarctic krill indicator is Fragilurosis antarctica. Complete understanding of the physical, chemical, biological process as well as the interaction in the ocean will be useful for assessment of primary production and fisheries production over the continental shelf areas. A thorough understanding of the various oceanographic process is important for finding a satisfactory solution to the major problem of the difference in the fisheries production in open ocean and coastal region. Finally, I would like to acknowledge our university respected Vice Chancellor Dr. G. Sukumar, then beloved Dean Dr. B. Sundramurthy, then my head Department of Aquatic Environment Management Dr. P. Padmavati, providing this opportunity to present my webinar in this FOFP online training course. Then finally, I would like to thank InCash Director and the FOFP course coordinators and as well as InCash organizers. If you have any doubt, kindly mail to this mail, then I will clarify your doubts. Thank you, Ananda. If you have any questions, please put in chat box and then I will give you answer. Yeah, I have received one question. Generally, it is clear that the planktonic activities are good indicators of fish production, but why are these specific fish types in different ocean biomes of the world? If you see the circulation pattern where the upwelling regions are happening, it is mixing the nutrients and it will make a particular planktonic group in particular environment conditions, it will survive. So like if you come for in India, southwest region of India, Arabian Sea, especially in the Arabian Sea, then oil sudden, it will eat more number of fragile oceanica. During southwest monsoon, this production will be more. Why? Because that southwest monsoon is bringing a lot of nutrients from landward side to ocean side. That whatever the nutrients are coming, then that time it will make use of by phytoplankton. Then that, especially that particular community will use these kind of nutrients, it will make much more productive. In this kind of phenomenon will occur in different places. Then wherever the nutrients, western nutrients, what are the different structures, like if diatom will be there, then silica will be more important. to make that kind of sales, then kind of fishery will be there. Second questions will be, sir, is the presence of bioluminescence is an indication of high chlorophyll? What pH value is a good indicator for presence of high chlorophyll in dorsal fish? If normally pH in ocean always in buffered conditions, where earlier it was 8.3, now it's due to climate change or impact, it's gradually reduced to 8.21. But always preferable for fish will be 7.5 to 8. Why? Because the near neutral conditions, then fish biological activities, then other primary production part will be more. Then always the chlorophyll production pH is 7.5 to 8.5. It will be more feasible for open ocean. If you come for any freshwater inlet, it will be 7.5 to 8 is optimum. For fish and chlorophyll will be in ocean, 7.5 to 8.5 always recommended. What are the depths of thermals in Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal? If Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal, if you see in Bay of Bengal side, stratification will be more. Why? Because that if freshwater influx will be more, it will may highly stratified. If highly stratified means it will block nutrient mixing or subsurface layer of water mixing the top surface layer of water. It will also make certain depths, like if you go for thermocline depth, if you see here it will be in 70 meter. If you come for Arabian Sea, then if you go for here less in from will be there, here around 90 meter will be there, up depth will be there. Is there any questions? Is there any other questions or only three? Okay. Thank you, one and all, for attending this lecture. I hope you people are enjoying this lecture as well as your lectures. I request everyone to be attentive until the training program end. Thank you very much.